thanks for joining us again for another installment of our Youth Week of Prayer. Since Sunday, you have been hearing some inspiring music and wonderful presentations from the youth at the Sydenham Seventh-day Adventist Church. And we're here again tonight, Wednesday night. Now, Wednesday night will be a little bit different because we'll be having special prayer just for you. Of course, the regular wonderful presentation and stirring music, but we'll be having a special prayer just for you. Again, we want to remind you about some proper tips as it relates to our COVID-19. Ensure that you're maintaining your social distancing and doing some proper hand washing. But again, we'll have our presentations for you, so stay tuned and prepare to be blessed.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our Wednesday night program. We trust that you will be blessed as we worship this evening. We are going to start with the singing of number 294, There's Power in the Blood. God we serve. We're going to do number 183. I will sing of Jesus' love.
I will sing of Jesus' love, sing of Him who first loved me for He left.
I will sing His love.
what a great God we serve. All right, we are going to mix things up a little bit this evening. We're going to go into some choruses, just a few choruses before we go into the rest of the program. I've got my mind made up, and I won't turn back, for I want to see my Jesus someday.
I've got my mind made up, and I won't turn back, because I want to see my Jesus someday. I've got my mind made up, and I won't turn back, because I want to see my Jesus someday. I've got my mind made up, and I won't turn back, because I want to see my Jesus someday.
The rock is higher than I. Jehovah hides me. I'm under the rock. Go tell my enemies I'm under the rock. Jehovah hides me.
Can we do that one more time? I am under the rock.
I am under the rock. The rock is higher than I.
Jesus, Jesus' name so sweet. Every rock we rock upon Jesus. Jesus' name so sweet. Jesus' name so sweet. Emmanuel's name so sweet. Jesus' name so sweet. Emmanuel's name so sweet. Every rock we rock upon Jesus. Jesus' name so sweet. Every rock we rock upon Jesus. Jesus' name.
Fire, fire, fire.
Fire, fire, fire. Fire fall on me. Fire, fire, fire. Fire fall on me. On the day of Pentecost, fire fall on me. On the day of Pentecost, fire fall on me.
Won't it be a time?
Won't it be a time when we get over yonder? Won't it be a time when we get over yonder? Won't it be a time when we get over yonder? Oh, won't it be a time? We're gonna sing and shout, dance about when we get over yonder. Sing and shout, dance about when we get over yonder. Sing and shout, dance about when we get over yonder. Oh, won't it be a time?
Press along, saints, press along in God's own way. Press along, saints, press along in God's own way. Persecution we must bear. Victory. Press along, saints, press along in God.
then we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. Amen.
Our Father who art in heaven, again, Lord, we want to give you thanks that you have been with us. We are grateful, Lord, for the privilege that we could come to you in prayer, knowing, Lord, that you are always willing to hear us, as your word have said, that we should come boldly to your throne of grace, where we'll find grace to help us in our time of need. Heavenly Father, this is indeed a time of need for all of us. For Lord, the enemy has made an attack against your people. And we pray at this time that as your word said, that when the enemy shall come in like a flood, the Spirit of God will raise up a standard against him. So Heavenly Father, we pray that your blood again will cover our lives, that you will cover our church, that you will cover our government, that you will cover our island, that you will keep us, Lord, that your angels, that excel in strength, may surround us. Especially, Lord, do we pray for our young people. We pray, Lord, that in these time of great adversity, that they will stand for you, that, Lord, they will be true to their calling, that even though, Lord, we meet not as we used to in your sanctuary, that they will look up to the sanctuary that is in heaven, that they will look to the most holy place where you intercede on our behalf, that their faith will hold, and that, Lord, at last, when you shall come, you will be able to say, these are my children, and you have come to save them. Now bless and keep us during this week of prayer. And Lord, we pray that we will continue to be strong, not in our own strength, but in the power of your might. Now bless, especially tonight, the one that will present the word, the one who will break the bread of life. May your Holy Spirit rest heavily upon that one, Lord. May your peace and your presence be upon them. And as they open their words, their mouth to speak, may you speak through them. And may our hearts be lifted above the things of this earth. And may we look up, for your words have said that your redemption draweth nigh. That our redemption draweth nigh. Bless and keep us, Lord. And may your presence ever be with your people. For we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Has given so much to this church, even in his youth. He has worked as a member of the AY department, and he has really served well. He is none other than Brother Ijon Thomas. He is going to be sharing the word of God with us this evening. I pray that you will just whisper a prayer in your hearts for him, that the words that he speaks will bless the hearts of all who hear. Before he speaks to us, though, Sister Nikita Wallace will bless our hearts with a special song.
Oh, the blood, crimson love, price of life's demand. Shameful sin placed on. The hope of every man. Oh, the blood of Jesus washes me. Oh, the blood of Jesus shed for me. Thank you. How can this be?
It is my hope that in this trying time, you still seek or can seek and find happiness. Needless to say, let us continue to endeavor to be faithful and continue on our journey on truly learning what it means to forgive. Our topic today under the theme of forgiveness is a human embrace. Consider, humans cannot offer forgiveness without first having accepted the forgiveness God offers to them or to us. Our ability to forgive others stems from the forgiveness we accept from God. It is through God's offer of forgiveness that his plan to restore his creation can be so plead on behalf of your people that you may have mercy on them and restore the health of those who may be ill in this time. Help us, Lord, to lose pride so that we may be willing to accept forgiveness, that we may be a vessel for you, and grant unto us that forgiveness so that we can pass it to others, dear Lord. I ask that the words that you have given me will be well received and used to fulfill your purpose. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, so for the past 3 nights, the theme of focus has been forgiveness. Last night, we learned some of the ways Jesus brought forgiveness to the earth while he was here. When he left, he instructed us to carry on his work. Paul talks about this in our theme passage, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Turn your Bibles, those at home, and if you'd like to read with me, you can. All right, verse 18. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. In the second half of this verse, Paul names the ministry Jesus gave to us after he left. What is it? Now read verse 19. Let's see. To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. There are two parts to this verse, or of this verse. The first part contains the what and the how. What did God do? Well, he came to earth through Christ to reconcile, not to reconcile himself, but who? The entire world. And the how does God reconcile people to himself? The answer was described in the next phrase. He did this by not imputing their trespasses against them. In other words, by not punishing them or holding them completely accountable for their sins or offenses. The second part is what God gave us to do. What do you think it means that God has committed unto us the word of reconciliation? This is still the first part of our embrace of a reconciliation. Our willingness to forgive and restore, right? First, we talked about A, God opening his arms because forgiveness can only come from the Creator. And B, now we're going to talk about people opening their arms to offer forgiveness to others. A great example for us of how we can be forgiving lies in the Old Testament. It's the story of Joseph. Regardless of the struggles he endured with the people around him, that is his jealous brothers, and him being sold into slavery by them, the story culminates to Joseph being gifted by God the position of Prime Minister of Egypt and minister in charge of famine management. When a famine came upon the lands, his brothers came bowing before him for grain, not even recognizing who they were bowing before. What happens in the first three verses? How do you think the brothers felt when this mighty Egyptian official declared himself to be their lost brother, Joseph? Why? I would have you put on Joseph's shoe for a second. How would you have been tempted to treat them? We can be sure that it certainly was not God's plan for Joseph's brothers to be so hateful or to sell Joseph as a slave. God could have gotten Joseph to Egypt some other way, right? But ever since sin began, God has been in the business of bringing good, even out of the greatest evil. Joseph had learned that, because from the very beginning, when he was young and frightened and didn't know what would happen to him, he had chosen to cling to God and to faith. We can do that too. Did Joseph's brothers close the embrace and accept his forgiveness? Well, we do not know the details of how they reacted at that time, but let us look or turn to Genesis chapter 50, verses 15 to 21, and see what it says. Turn with me. Verses 15 to 21. And the king of Egypt spake to the Hebrew midwives, of which the name of the one was Shifra. Genesis 50, verses 15 to 21. And when Joseph's brethren saw that their father was dead, they said, Joseph will peradventure hate us, and will certainly requite us all the evil which we did unto him. And they sent a messenger unto Joseph, saying, Thy father did command before he died, saying, So shall he say unto Joseph, Forgive, I pray thee now, the trespass of thy brethren and their sin, for they did unto thee evil. And now we pray thee, forgive the trespass of the servants of the God thy father. And Joseph wept when they spake unto him. And his brethren also went and fell down before his face. And they said, Behold, we be thy servants. And Joseph said unto them, Fear not, for I am in the place of God. But as for you, ye thought evil against me. But God meant it unto good, to bring to pass as it is this day, to save much people alive. Now therefore fear he not, I will nourish you and your little ones. And he comforted them and spake kindly unto them. It looks as though the brothers were never really certain of Joseph's total forgiveness, doesn't it? Now, why do you think Joseph wept in verse 17? Joseph's story is a great example for us that even really terrible things can be forgiven. Another example comes from John chapter 4, which was mentioned on previous nights, the story of the woman at the well. Jesus offered the woman forgiveness. Try to recall what she had done next. To draw your memory, let us look at John chapter 4, verses 28 to 30. It reads, "The woman then left her water pot and went her way into the city and saith to the men, Come, see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? They went out of the city and came unto him." Now, let's think for a minute. What kind of life did this woman live before or have before this? What kind of relationship did she seem to have with other town's people? Why choose to fetch water around midday when the sun's heat had peaked and not with the other woman in the morning? She isolated herself, and though she was not seemingly close to these people, she was eager to share her experience and the good news she had learned. Though the Bible did not explicitly make mention of her reasons, wouldn't it be reasonable to deduce that this woman was willing to offer forgiveness after it had been offered to her? The whole town of Sychar was changed because of this woman. Who could have predicted that the outcast would change everything because of one conversation with a strange man at the village well? It seems that many did forgive the woman for her past life and accepted her forgiveness of them for being judgmental against her. Perhaps whole new friendships began. Sadly, it's also possible that some people did not give or accept forgiveness. In that case, it would have been up to the woman to remain in an attitude of repentance and live a new life in Jesus, empowered by the living spirit or the living spring of the Holy Spirit that Jesus promised her. Perhaps even over time, others would see that she really had changed, even if they did not. Even if they never came to a point of reconciliation, she would need to continue to faithfully maintain an attitude of forgiveness. That is because there is a separate reason for being forgiving besides showing mercy to the person who has sinned against you. It's good for you. Whether or not the person never repents, it is very damaging to us if or when we walk around lacking the willingness to forgive someone. It darkens our hearts sometimes more than the original sin against us did. We sometimes obsess over it, perpetually thinking of the harm that was inflicted on us by the hands or actions of others. Sometimes we imagine ways we can even get even and even attempt those ways. Now we've sinned just as much as the other person did. How does that help? We have to remember that forgiving is not excusing. People who think they can forgive or can't forgive, rather, usually think they are being asked to just let something go, to excuse it as if it didn't matter. It did matter. If it didn't matter, then it would be considered a normal human mistake that, as such, would not require forgiveness. When something or an action is a sin, there is no excuse for it. However, our refusing to forgive doesn't hurt the other person as much as it hurts us. Someone once said that refusing to forgive is like drinking poison and hoping that the other person will die. God has committed the work of reconciliation to us. That means he's depending on us to do for others what he did for us. Think about this. How much harder is it for him to cleanse someone else of their unrighteousness if us humans persistently label that person with their sin? Finally, Let's consider a story from our own time. Now, just a side note, the details of this story, though factual, have been changed to ensure the protection of privacy or privacy. A young woman, we'll call her Leah, was married with two small children. She knew that her husband, Zach, was not truly happy, but she believed it was because he had not completely committed himself to God. She did not know he was unhappy with the marriage itself. She prayed constantly and did everything she could to be the perfect wife and mother, hoping that somehow her husband would come to God and to her. As time went on, Zach became more and more angry. At first, he only shouted and swore. Leah forgave him. Then he began getting violent, breaking their possessions and damaging the house. Leah again forgave him and prayed even harder. Then he started to hit her. It was at this point that an older woman Leah knew took her aside at church. Leah tried to laugh, blaming her bruise on a fall, but the other woman, Miss Skeena, did not smile. "Leah, why don't you bring the children and come home with me to dinner? Let's talk and pray together." That afternoon, with the two children asleep, Mrs. Skeena succeeded in breaking through Leah's barriers and getting at the truth. "You can't keep living like this," she told Leah. But I know that God sees marriage as sacred and wants me to forgive. Leah protested. "Yes, forgive. You are making excuses for him." "It's not the same thing," Mrs. Skeena told her. "You are also keeping Zach from facing any consequences for his actions. God loves Zach and wants him to change. How can he do that if you keep Zach from ever truly realizing what he is doing to you and the children?" "He never hits the children," said Leah quickly. "He harms the children by harming you," Mrs. Skeena said firmly. "Worst of all, he is harming himself. If you truly love him, you have to let him face his sin, praying hard that God will be able to get a hold of him." "I will help you. Pastor will help you." It was the hardest thing Leah had ever had to do. Telling Zach she loved him too much to allow him to go on hurting her, their children, and their family. "You have to get help," she told him, weeping. "I will pray every day for you to come back. The healed and loving man I know you can be." Zach was furious. He accused Leah of not loving him, of not being a Christian, of destroying their marriage. He insisted he had never done anything a husband shouldn't do. He shouted and swore and threatened, but Leah's pastor and his wife, Mrs. Skeena, and the members of both Zach's and Leah's family were all there. They took him away. They would have helped him find housing and counseling, but Zach disappeared. Heartbroken, Leah struggled to live in an attitude of forgiveness, even though she didn't know what the end would be. Would he turn to God? Would he come back? Would he ever accept her forgiveness? What do you think? Could you forgive in this situation? Even if the other person never came back, never accepted your forgiveness, never even admitted they'd done anything wrong, could you still hold your heart's arms open in the first step of the embrace of reconciliation? Discuss this amongst yourselves at home with your families. Parting words. Forgiveness is the key to the restoration of God's creation, the world. We should be keen on ensuring that we fulfill our role to allow God's plan to be complete. Our duty is not just to learn how to be forgiving, but to practice it. It is through this practice that others will be able to learn and adopt these principles. As we interact with people daily, let us ask God to help us to see others with new eyes, seeing that all of us need forgiveness and mercy all the time. As God forgave, so should we.
Thank you. Wow, what a message. I was blessed. I know you were too. When God uses his young people, amazing things can happen. You heard from one on Sunday and Monday, and you just heard from another. Tomorrow night, we continue again for our Youth Week of Prayer. So join us, same time, tomorrow night, as we continue our Youth Week of Prayer. Remember that we go to Thursday night, and you can also join us on Sabbath on our YouTube page and on our Facebook page. Have yourself a good evening, and God bless you.